Good morning. Welcome to OCBC. Glad you're here and not snowed in, iced in, rained in. Let's stand together. That is the right song. Yes, it is. We'll sing.
So amazing, Lord, we've come to give you thanks for all you've done. Because of your love, we're forgiven. Because of your love, our hearts are clean. We lift you up with songs of so amazing, Lord, we come to give you thanks for all you've done. Because of your love, we're forgiven. Because of your love, our hearts are clean. We lift you up with songs of
announcement. The annual church retreat. Who can tell me when it is?
It's last weekend of April.
Last weekend of April, the 28th and through the 30th of April. So get that on your calendars. There's going to be more information coming soon on how to sign up and if there's going to be anything special going on other than just special people. But yeah, so the details will be coming in the future. But get that on your calendars, last weekend in April. And there's one more announcement.
So, ma'am, do you want to tell people why that random puzzle is sitting back there? Because it makes no sense.
Our random puzzle, please take a look at it. It's the Mad Hatter Tea Party. Because we're having the Mad Hatter Tea Party on April Fool's Day, April 1. More details next week and places you can sign up to help. And come, if you want to come, we need you to sign up. We'll have invitations. Hand out to your friends, your lady friends, and the men folk are going to be serving our tea this year.
Yay!
And we have two ladies who are in charge of deciding what we're going to eat, and I'm sure it'll be fantastic. So put that, save that date.
Okay. I have an announcement too.
Okay.
We are in need of an individual or a couple of people or a family to clean the church on a weekly basis. Hasn't been done for a while. The family that was doing it isn't able to do it anymore. Church has their own cleaning supplies. We have a checklist. Take you an hour or two, probably a week if it's more than one person. It's mostly cleaning bathrooms and tidying up the kitchen, vacuuming floors. It's actually the only paid position at church. It's $35 a week, so there is some compensation for your time and for your gas to get here. So if you're interested in doing that, we typically do it on the 3 or 4 month rotation, so you don't have to like sign up for all of time. And if you want to renew afterwards, that's fine. We used to have people like competing to who would clean the church, and now we're out of people that want to or are able to do it. So let me know. That'd be great.
Okay. Any other announcements?
Let's stand. In Sunday school, John admitted that he didn't understand the ins and outs of salvation. Well, me neither. So, I don't think anybody can claim to understand just the pure mechanics of it all. Hence this song's title, Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery. We just actually sang about salvation, too, in this song as well. There's a phrase in here. It would be confusing for somebody who's an outsider, and I always want to think about people that may not understand. I mean, again, not fully understanding, but the phrase, a true and better Adam. We've been talking about Adam, of course, during church and Sunday school as we're going through Genesis. I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians. where I want to start. It's a long chapter. It's like 60 verses. I'm not going to do the whole thing. So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown in a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there's also a spiritual body. Thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam, or the second Adam, became a living, life-giving spirit. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. The first man was of the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. And again, the second verse in this song says, the true and better Adam come to save the hellbound man, Christ, the second Adam, if that wasn't apparent. The great and sure fulfillment of the law, in him we stand. And speaking of standing, let's stand.
Mystery in the dawning of the King. Be the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our longing, in our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Come behold the wondrous mystery, be the perfect Son of Man. In his living, in his suffering, never trace nor stain of sin. See the true price of our
Dismissed.
Matt has asked that for our scripture reading this morning, that we read the first 16 verses of Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, beginning in verse 1. Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith, Abel offered God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as a righteous man when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, he still speaks, even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of righteousness that comes by faith. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land. As a stranger in a foreign country, he lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations whose architect and builder is God. By faith, Abraham, even though he was past age and Sarah herself was barren, was enabled to become a father because he considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and he as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as countless as the sand on the seashore. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. And they admitted that they were aliens and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they'd been thinking of the country they'd left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were looking for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them.
Before we get started, we had an elder meeting recently, and just want to say on behalf of the elders, we really appreciate you all and your willingness to serve the body, to show up and not just, you turn on a television program, what's on today? But so many of you serving, Sunday school or in ways that aren't necessarily maybe your preference or favorite, just showing up and being sacrificial and loving one another. It's just a real blessing to be a part of a body where you guys show your gifts. And it shows us as a team of elders, the Holy Spirit and who the Lord is in a really real way, whether we do it together on a Sunday morning like this or whether it's scattered, throughout the week. So it's a real blessing to be a part of that. Thank you. Last time I shared from this pulpit, which was a couple weeks ago, I encourage you to be really careful how you hear the word, to hear with an open heart, ready to change based upon what the Lord says in his scriptures. Before we begin this morning, I want to offer a different piece of advice about the nature of the books we call scripture, or commonly called the Bible. You shouldn't read the Bible like you read or you listen to any other story. When we read a good book or we watch an interesting television program with a great story, we kind of get caught up in the details, right? How they weave together a story to produce the twists and turns that arrive at the conclusion. I remember recently going to see the movie Avatar, the second one in the theaters, because a friend of Eli's wanted to go see it. And afterward, we get together and we talk about, was this a plot hole? Was this in a plot hole? What was good about it? We just kind of evaluate the story in and of itself. And we get caught in all these ideas. And when we listen to the Bible in a similar way, we can kind of get distracted by seeming plot holes that aren't brought to their conclusions. Things we're curious about that we don't really get an answer to. You know, what was the fruit in the Garden of Eden that Adam and Eve, was that a pomegranate? Was it an apple? What kind of fruit was it? Or, what kind of, these questions we tend to ask because we're naturally curious people. And that can be really distracting. When we meet here on a Sunday morning, and we believe, we spend the time in the Word and looking at the Scriptures because we believe that they're profitable, that the truth within these pages communicated by our Lord and Father is stuff about God's character and about His creation that we need to hear. There's other information out there that we are curious about. There's other truth that's besides God's truth. But what we need is here. And this scripture warns us of temptation, and it tells us of our own natures. And so my encouragement to you this morning is like a son or a daughter, and I've been there. You know, when your dad tells you a story that you've heard before, you kind of go, yeah, Dad, I know all that. I've heard that before. That you put away that spirit, and you listen and wonder why your Father in heaven would, in His wisdom, choose to communicate this truth this morning. And hopefully the Lord can use me this morning to communicate what He's got in the book of Genesis chapter 4 as we read. Now Adam knew his wife Eve, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord. And again she bore his brother Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, and Cain a worker of the ground. In the course of time, Cain brought to the Lord an offering of the fruit of the ground, and Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering, but for Cain and his offering he had no regard. So Cain was very angry, and his face fell. The Lord said to Cain, why are you angry, and why has your face fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is contrary to you, but you must rule over it. Cain spoke to Abel, his brother, and when they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is Abel, your brother? He said, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? And the Lord said, what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground. And now you are cursed from the ground, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it shall no longer yield to you its strength. You shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth. Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Behold, you have driven me today away from the ground, and from your face I shall be hidden. I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me. Then the Lord said to him, not so. If anyone kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And the Lord put a mark on Cain, lest any who found him should attack him. Then Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Let's pray really fast here. Lord, we just invite your presence in with us this morning. Not that you aren't already here, but Lord, we ask that you would open our hearts, that your spirit might speak to us this morning, and that we would be changed by the truth of your word and what you have for us. Thank you. So this morning, I really only have time to address in detail the first section of this chapter. There's a lot of interesting information in the rest of it. I encourage you to spend some time in the rest of it, but we'll really focus on these two sections, on Cain's story, and then we'll just have a brief amount of time at the very end where we'll look at some of the other questions that came up this morning. Last time we looked at the fall of Adam and Eve. Actually, the time before last we looked at the fall of Adam and Eve. Last time we looked at the curse. But last time I was up here, I asked, how did things go so wrong so quickly? Adam and Eve are created in the garden. Everything's perfect. And it just collapses just so quickly. And so my temptation this morning was to ask, how did things escalate so quickly? You know, for the, I don't know, like as a parent, I think about that. Like the kids are playing peacefully and everything's great and you're just about ready to say so. And then suddenly like, rah! And then there's like, you know, a huge fight in the other room and like it's over something. And I don't know, like to me, the page, it's hard to jump from Genesis chapter 3 where they've taken the fruit, they're ashamed, and then suddenly like someone's murdering someone. And it's not even generations past. We don't skip years and years. This is like the fifth generation. This is like their kids, right? The next two people we meet. But I don't think that's the real key question we should look at this morning. I don't think this passage is primarily about the first murder. And literally every time I've read this passage, I've thought, this is just the first murder. This is a chronicle of history, and this is the first time a murder happens, and so that's why this is in the scripture. I don't think I've ever stopped to really ask the hard questions about why Cain killed Abel, or what else is going on here, and what this passage can tell me about myself, about worship, about the enemy, and the danger of sin or a false sense of assurance in my own life. This passage tells us a lot about this. It tells us much about the power of sin, but also tells us much about the character of God and the battle between us and our enemies, our true enemies. So the question we'll ask this morning is, what is going on here at the heart of things? For a moment here, let's pause and take a quick recap. When you watch a television series for a while, if you're not binge-watching it, they show you certain scenes ahead of the episode, right? To remind you, to clue you in, oh, you're supposed to remember these things in this next episode so that it makes sense. And sometimes when I read the scriptures, I wish that God would like come down and be like, previously seen in Genesis. And he would like explain to me so that I'd know what to pay attention to. Because every time I pick up the scriptures, sometimes I think like, oh, this is Genesis chapter 4. And I could just forget what happened in Genesis chapter 3 as I read Genesis chapter 4. And I just keep plugging along, doing my daily devotions. And I miss important connections when I do that. So let's do a quick recap. It's easy to do right now. Good luck if we get into Romans or something like that. God creates the world good. He makes man in his own image, man and woman, and he gives them purpose to fill the world with his blessing. Adam and Eve both choose to distrust God, and they invite sin into their lives in an attempt to be wise in their own eyes, following the temptation, the enemy, and their own way. Things do not go well. They lose their intimacy with one another, with God, and are sent out of the garden. They learn that the work they will do now will require toil. Childbirth and their relationship will be bittersweet. And God provides them with clothes to hide their shame through sacrifice. And he speaks of a future descendant of theirs who will provide them deliverance from the enemy through his own sacrifice and victory. So it's in this context, roughly speaking, that we come to Genesis chapter 4. Now after this, the next thing we read of is that Adam and Eve get started on what God called them to. They seem to stick close to the garden, staying in Eden. Remember that this was the garden in Eden. Eden was a region. And they're not in the garden itself. And they have kids. Eve seems soft-hearted towards the Lord. It reads, "Now Adam knew his wife Eve, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, 'I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord.'" Seems like she honors the Lord in her childbirth. I wonder if she had in mind the promise and wondered if Cain would fulfill that promise that God had given them. The children grow into men and they forge their own relationships with God and with his jobs for them. Cain chooses to work the soil like his father, following the example of the Lord and planting a garden. Abel keeps sheep, also like his father, and keeping the animals and providing for them. Scripture says that Abel was a keeper of sheep and Cain was a worker of the ground. So far, so good, right? Both men appeared to be doing what the Lord called them to, but then something happens that reveals a difference in their hearts. We read, "In the course of time, Cain brought to the Lord an offering of the fruit of the ground, and Abel brought the firstborn of his flock and of their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering, but for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. So Cain was very angry, and his face fell." In the course of time, they choose to offer the Lord a gift. As an aside, I kind of wonder how they knew to do that. There aren't a whole lot of specifics here as to what the gift was, except for that Cain's is an offering of his work, and Abel's is an offering of his work, but also gives the denotation of it that it's a first fruit, right? It says that it's a firstborn of his flock and of their fat portions. It seems as if Abel's gift is the one that requires faith in God and contains sacrifice. Abel brought his best, looking to the Lord for his success, not to his own work. We're not told what's in Cain's heart originally, but the Lord isn't pleased with his offering, and Cain doesn't respond with sadness, he responds with anger. This morning I'm not here to tell you the dangers of being angry, but it's worth observing that in several places in Scripture, we are warned about that danger of allowing our anger to rule us. Can you, kids, tell me what story this is from? Do you do well to be angry? Anybody know which person's in the image? It's not Cain. Huh? Anybody over the age of, under the age of 18, tell me. Malachi?
Jonah.
Jonah, that's right. Nice work, yeah. Remember the story of Jonah? So Jonah goes, he finally repents, he gets spat out of the big fish, he finally goes to the city of Nineveh, he preaches, and they listen. And he's not excited about that. No, he's angry. He goes up on the city, and he finds maybe a rock to sit under, and he's waiting. He wants the Lord to crush his enemies. And the Lord provides a plant, and the plant grows up, and it provides Jonah some shade. Jonah's really excited about the shade. Then the Lord provides a worm to kill the plant. And Jonah gets really upset with the Lord, and the Lord asks him, are you well to be angry about the plant? And Jonah says, well, yes, I'm well to be angry about the plant. And then God tells him about what he's really angry about. Anger is dangerous because it focuses our attention, often wrongly, on what we have to blame or who we think we have to blame for the negative emotion we're facing. When I was a special ed teacher, we would tell the kids that anger equals a negative emotion plus blame. Cain, too, ignores that God is communicating with him because he's angry. Does he blame Abel? Does he blame God? Does he blame his parents? Does he blame anyone but himself? It seems like it. God has already spoken to Cain once through this offering, but he speaks again when he notices Cain to be angry, warning Cain specifically about the danger of his sin, speaking a specific help to the situation. The Lord says to Cain, why are you angry, and why has your face fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is contrary to you, but you must rule over it. This is so like our Lord. The Bible says all creation speaks his glory. Proverbs speaks of how the righteous prosper generally. But the Lord isn't content with us to just know him through general revelation, to figure it out by observing the heavens. The Lord even speaks to us specifically in our situation. Perhaps not as clearly as to Cain, but Cain didn't have the scriptures. He didn't have the church. So God speaks to him, telling him not to be mastered by sin manifested in his anger, but to be in charge of it himself. Cain remains silent in his response to God, and this speaks to me of his heart. Perhaps he viewed himself as doing enough for God. I'm the firstborn after all. I'm a tiller of the soil like Adam and like you, God. What more do you want from me? I picked the right job. Why am I not good enough? He may have been thinking. But he says nothing to the Lord's response, to the second time that the Lord speaks to him. Cain's response, in fact, is to trick his brother into getting alone away from his parents and to kill him in his jealousy. What was he thinking? He really wasn't. Did he think that he would get ahead by doing this, that he would reclaim the Lord's favor, his right as the firstborn? He refused to listen to both of the Lord's interventions or to think of others. We read, Cain spoke to Abel, his brother. When they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. So what's next? Do we read that God runs in and punishes him? That the God he saw is out to get him comes to get him? No, in fact. God comes to him knowing what has been done, and he gives him a chance, like he gave his parents a chance, to confess his sin. And he asks him, Where is Abel your brother? How does Cain respond to the Lord? Well, he doubles down in his anger, triples down, and he lies to the Lord. He says, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? Of course he knew where his brother was, but he has the audacity in his anger, fueled by his rage or his self-loathing, to just, I don't know. He lies to God. He knows it's God, and he lies to him. So the Lord disciplines Cain. In his love, the Lord disciplines him. He removes from Cain the work in which he trusted and the status he trusted in. Cain is no longer the firstborn son of promise that he thought he was. He is now a fugitive and a wanderer in the earth. And he can no longer trust in his father's work. The work that he used to do in the soil will no longer bear fruit from him. Finally, Cain realizes this is bad news, and it seems like it's possible he may see a bit of the truth here, finally. Not for lack of trying, Cain does come around to some sense of sadness here. Cain is upset about the punishment. He says, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Now, it's unclear here what Cain is saying. It's perhaps true, because this was written in ancient Hebrew. It's possible that Cain is saying, my shame is too great for me to atone for. Or that he's saying, my punishment is greater than I can bear. It's unclear. And the reason I bring this up is because we're curious to know, does Cain repent? Does he finally realize God is right and I am wrong and I should do things the Lord's way? And because the words are unclear, we need to look at the context to try to figure out what's in his heart, right? He does realize that he needs to leave the Lord's presence in Eden, but at least part of him is still stuck on how others will perceive him. He says, you have driven me today away from the ground, and from your face I shall be hidden. I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me. He's worried about how he'll be perceived by others. If Cain does repent, it seems in line with the same sort of spirit as from before. He doesn't wander too long from the presence of the Lord. In fact, he founds a city in the land of Nod, which is east of Eden. And his clan, his people, his offspring, gain success in a very worldly sense, similar to how Cain, their great-great-grandfather, sought worldly success. But they grow in their wickedness and in their removal from the Lord's will. Lamech is mentioned in the end of Genesis chapter 4. He's fifth in line to Cain, and following in Cain's footsteps, he gives full vent to his desires and achieves worldly success. His children invent livestock keeping and certain types of music, but he mistreats the two women who he calls his wives, and he kills a man for insulting him and boasts about it in front of others. We're not sure if Cain repents, but his descendants sure seem to walk away from the desire to be close to the Lord. How are you doing? You guys tracking okay? Okay. So three times God speaks, three times Cain hardens his heart and doesn't fully listen. What can we see in this passage about success and repentance? What can we see about the Lord? Is the Lord out to get Cain? I think it's hard to make that claim. God reaches out to him even after his sin. Cain's the one who leaves the presence of the Lord. Blinded by his own ambition, perhaps, or at least his worldly focus, he wants success and he looks to himself to get it, but he loses even the success in which he seeks. As we continue to work through the book of Genesis, we're going to see this theme of conniving and grasping in Genesis, especially as it results to getting to be the firstborn. While the vehicle of blessing in our culture isn't necessarily being firstborn, and parents tend to divide their estates evenly, parental blessing and favor was one of the primary vehicles of success in the ancient world. So when we read of someone, perhaps Jacob and Esau or others, trying and conniving to be that firstborn son, we can see that same spirit of ambition that we saw in Cain. In truth, this story reminds me of myself in a lot of ways, in an earthly sense and in a heavenly sense. In an earthly sense, I think of the question, how many times I disdained the words of my earthly father, thinking that I knew everything he was going to tell me ahead of time and refusing to listen despite his great love for me. His love was imperfect, yes, but his love was filled with more wisdom than I had. If you're a child listening this morning, I want to encourage you to think about why your parents teach you. Consider the words of Proverbs chapter 1. Hear, my son, your father's instruction, and forsake not your mother's teaching, for they are a graceful garland for your head and pendants for your neck. Or Proverbs chapter 3. My son, do not forget my teaching, and let your heart not forsake my commandments. For length of days and years of life and peace they will add to you. If you're a kid of any age, I pray that the words of your parents would be to you a blessing. See that they love you by caring for you, and let them lead you to your heavenly Father, who loves you so much more than they are capable of. My own love, definitely included. This story also reminds me of my relationship with my heavenly Father. I rejected my heavenly Father too for many years before I returned to him. Like Cain, I was really good at looking good. And for a long time, the spiritual outward healthiness that it looked like I had wasn't true or honest. My heart wasn't in it. I was looking for the favor of others, whether I was in a church or whether I was at school. Similarly to Cain, I exiled myself, thinking I could do it myself. But God's mercy was steadfast. It remained for me. When he called, and I humbled myself and answered, his mercy, like that of the father of the prodigal son, was abundant. And before I answered him, he waited expectantly, desiring my return. So back to the passage at hand. We might ask ourselves, now what? Cain's exiled, Abel's dead. Have the wicked prospered? What are Adam and Eve doing during this whole process? And what of God's plan to deliver from sin? Time would fail to tell us, ask of these things in detail, but if we pause here, we might ask these questions. Is the story over before it's even begun? First question I want to address is this. Have the wicked prospered? We might contrast Lamech versus Enoch. Enoch is the fifth son of Seth. Seth is the child who God provides to Eve, to replace Abel, for Cain killed him. Lamech has great success, but it's a mirage. Outwardly, his family gains what it seems like Cain wanted, respect. People fear him, admire his family for their inventiveness, and he becomes famous, it seems. Contrast that with the fifth son of Seth, who stays in Eden. All we know about him is that Enoch lived 365 years, a relatively short time then, and then was no more because God took him. Like his great uncle Abel, he lived a life of faith. We know very little of his earthly accomplishments, but the Lord saw his heart and took him home. Jesus says in Mark 8, he says, in calling the crowd to him with the disciples, he says to them, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. This is such a great encouragement to me in my work. My success or failure does not come from the fruits of my labor or the praise of others, but if I can fix my eyes on the Lord and look to him for my reward, then I will know that my life won't have been lived in vain. The second question is what of Adam and Eve? Well, does Cain's sin crush God's promise? No. I don't know what Adam and Eve must have felt after learning what happened or how they learned of it. Perhaps they at first blamed themselves, but I hope they later came to see that Cain's choices were his own. What's clear is that they stay in Eden and that they glorify the Lord and the birth of Seth. God's promise to them will remain. If we are faithless, he will remain faithful. This is a great encouragement to me as a father. I imagine myself a far less effective father than Adam or Eve. They were 130 when they had Seth. I don't know how old they were when Cain and Abel were born. But to trust my children to their Heavenly Father and to encourage them to make their faith their own, trusting the Lord as best I can for His promise in our life is my prayer for my own fatherhood. Scripture says that you keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord is an everlasting rock. Isaiah 26. Or don't forget Psalm 37, which is all about our trust for him in the presence of wicked people who seem to prosper, which starts, fret not yourselves over evildoers as they seem to gain success through their evil actions, but that we ought to delight ourselves in the Lord, and that he will give us the desires of our heart, make our righteousness shine like the dawn, the justice of our cause like the noonday sun. And what of God's promise to deliver from sin? He does not abandon his people or his promise. God, we know, would later come to fulfill his own promise. Though he uses us to accomplish his purpose, it's his work. Our success is found in him, but it's also true that what God purposes, he works to accomplish. Listen to this passage from Romans 3, talking about God's people, the Jews. Then what advantage has the Jew? Or what value is there in circumcision? That is the covenant, which God, the sign that they would, the Jews would have in their own selves to denote that their fruitfulness came from the Lord. Paul writes, much in every way. To begin with, the Jews were entrusted with the oracles of God. What if some were unfaithful? Does their faithlessness nullify the faithfulness of God? By no means. Let God be true, though every one were a liar, as it is written, that you may be justified in your words and prevail when you are judged. God has intended that his people should remain faithful to him and accomplish his purposes, but even if they do not, he will remain faithful and he will prevail. But we know that God has not failed. God preserved for himself a people, even as we are members of that group, that we should accomplish his purposes in his strength. This is a great encouragement to me as a son. I serve an active God. He works to accomplish his purposes. Even as he spoke to Cain, he still speaks to us, even in our rebellion, to reconcile us and others to him. As a side note, this quote that Paul is quoting from in Romans chapter 3 comes from when David has sinned at his lowest point, and he says to God, against you, you only have I sinned, that you may be justified in your words and prevail when you are judged. David, in that moment of humility, like Paul, like Cain should have been, realized this, that what he needs more than anything is to be close to his Heavenly Father, even in the moment of his sin. As we draw to a close, I want to read a final passage and offer some encouragement, but I first want to give you some questions to consider as you think about this passage. How would you define success in your heart? To whom are you looking for your success? Another question I might ask is there any anger hardening your heart towards the Lord or towards others, and thereby robbing you of your full joy in the Lord? And then lastly, are you dwelling away from the presence of the Lord? Or despite your brokenness, are you cultivating an imperfect but increasing walk with him? As we come to the final passage today, this comes out of the book of Hebrews. It's a little bit later than the passage I had Jim read this morning. I'm going to read this passage, and then what we're going to do is we're going to take the Lord's Supper together. But as we consider these people of faith who lived before us, the writer of Hebrews writes, and all these, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. And have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by him, for the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastises every son whom he receives. It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? If you are left without discipline, in which we have all participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Besides this, we have had earthly fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time, as it seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good, that we may share in his holiness. For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Let's pray. Father God, we want to be unlike Cain. We want to submit to your discipline, to your words of encouragement in our lives. And we want to reach out with that same hope to people around us, that they too would turn and come to life. We know that sin in our lives is a powerful enemy. And so we pray that you would guard us from temptation, that you would keep us from falling into it. And that when we do choose sin, that your grace and your mercy would wake us back up again, that we would not be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin and so live unfruitful and robbed of joy sort of lives. Thank you for your word this morning. Thank you for your mercy and your grace, who you are as a God and Father, that you reach down to us, that you don't just leave us alone. You do not leave us as orphans, but you come to us. And thank you for speaking your words into our lives. As we go and scatter throughout the week and we do the work which you've assigned to us, pray that you would keep these words in our hearts and that you would keep us bound together as a body, encouraging one another. And we look forward to the day when you will come and you will make all things right in your holiness. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We're going to take the Lord's Supper now. I want to read to you out of the book of 1 John. John talks about fellowship. Another word we sometimes use for fellowship is communion, the communion of saints, that we would share something together. And when we take the Lord's Supper, we are in fact sharing. We're sharing with the Lord in his death, proclaiming his death over us, that through his death we come to life. But we're also sharing with one another, realizing that everyone who comes to the communion table comes to it at the same level. We're all needed. We're all needy, and we all need to come to the cross. There's no hierarchy when it comes to the communion table. I don't get, you know, to take it first because I'm somehow more holier than anyone else. When John, who saw the Lord Jesus, who lived among him, when he writes this to others, he writes this to the believers he's writing in the first letter of John. He says, "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked on and touched with our hands, concerning the word of life, the life was made manifest, and we have seen it and testified to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and made manifest to us." The reason he says this is, "That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim to you also, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete." We take the Lord's Supper proclaiming the Lord's death over our own lives, but we also proclaim the Lord's death over anyone's life who would come to the Lord's table this morning. And this is a time for people who are believers to come to this table. But it's also a time, if you're not in a place where you are following Jesus, for you to come to the Lord in faith. He offers this gift to you. He offered this gift for his disciples many, many thousands of years ago, but he offers this gift for us too. And so when we celebrate it this morning, I encourage you to celebrate it and to consider the Lord who offers it and to consider your role in offering that to others outside of this body.
Yeah, well, as we do gather in community together to do this, hope that in part of your reflection and confession time that you would think about these words as well, that we thank our Lord for his blood washing our sins away, and that indeed Jesus did pay it all, and all to him we owe. Let's stand.
I've been brought near. Your enemy.
last passage today is from Jude. Keep yourselves in the love of God, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. And have mercy on those who doubt. Save others by snatching them out of the fire. To others show mercy with fear, hating even the garment stained by the flesh. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless for the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, authority, before all time, now and forever. Amen.